Good morning. It's Sunday, April 18th, and we're continuing our look in the book of Acts to consider how we move as a church forward. One of the things that's very clear, very obvious, we're now in another provincial state of emergency, and without a doubt, this has meant that for the past year, we have felt somewhat paralyzed, somewhat inhibited in terms of how we act as a congregation, how we move forward as a group of people. The reality, though, is that this pandemic is one day going to end. We've been saying that for a while. Let's keep saying it until it happens. But the point that I want to make is that while this is happening, our world is not staying static. We may be in a state of emergency, but culture is still changing. Lives are still being affected. And the importance of what we have as followers of Jesus Christ cannot be stressed enough. Our mission, our purpose, is never more important than it is right now. Our society, our culture, our community needs what we have. But what we have needs to enter into this world in an effective, powerful way. A lot of things have changed. Since I entered into the ministry, a lot of things have changed. So how do we respond to that? One of the things that we have to be aware of is just the nature of the change itself. Carrie Newhoff, and we've been talking a lot about some of the things that he's produced over the course of the pandemic. One of the things he said was that if there's one trend worth watching right now, it's that North America likely has accelerated in its journey towards becoming a postmodern, post-Christian culture. And we may look at that and lament that, but the reality is we need to see the opportunity that that presents. You see, culture and the world around us changes. Our message does not. And if culture has changed and moved away from Christ, then that, in effect, creates new ground for us to look at and say, that has never been touched by the hand of our Lord yet. How can we minister there? And that's a big deal. And what I want us to see as we move into this sermon this morning is that the implications of what we're going to be looking at play out in more than just the church's theater of operations, so to speak. The reality is what we're talking about this morning plays out into how we function as followers of Christ, but also how we function as spouses, how we function as parents, co-workers, how we function in schools, wherever we operate, there is a place for us to demonstrate that we are followers of Jesus Christ. And the question becomes, how well do we demonstrate that? And what are the keys to doing it well? Let's look this morning. And while the series is in the book of Acts, I want us to look at some of the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples just before he was leaving to ascend into heaven, to go back to his Father. And they come to us from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. We begin to read in verse 19, and it says, "Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.'" What I want us to see in these verses is what Jesus didn't say. He didn't tell his disciples to go out into all the world and continue to be what you've been. He was asking them to take what he had commanded them, not the form of Judaism that they had been schooled in. They had been raised their whole lives to function within the Jewish system of belief, within the whole pattern of sacrifices and all of those kinds of things. And what Jesus was saying was, go into all the world and baptize them into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptize them into my name. Teach them to obey what I've commanded. There's something very different going on. You see, the Jewish people, while they were given this incredible position of being the children of God and the people of God, the problem that emerged was that they were very insular in that perspective and very insular in that position. They liked being the children of God when they were actually being that. What they wrestled with was how they were supposed to interact with the other nations around them. A classic example of this is in Jonah. You remember, Jonah was given this task to take the message of God, to take the message that they were to repent, and that message was to be delivered to the Ninevites. Jonah, in response to that, decided that he needed to go in the other direction. He wanted nothing to do with ministering to them. They were a people that needed to hear God's word to them, but he wasn't interested in delivering it. Part of this can be explained by the fact that the Ninevites, as a nation, as part of the Assyrian nation, had dealt some pretty harsh blows to the people of Israel. They had been at war with them. They had conquered them. They had done a lot of things that were a part of nations being at war. And as a result of that, Jonah didn't exactly feel a strong heart passion to minister to people who had been laying a beating on his own people. But what he missed in it was that God still had a heart for them. You see, it has always been true that God is not willing that any should perish, that all should come to repentance, and that all should know his salvation. It was just as true in Jonah's time as it is now in our time, as it was to the early disciples in the early church as they were hearing it from Jesus and the apostles. Nothing changed except the people's desire to minister and to function in that way. Jesus was calling the disciples to pick that up again. What he wasn't telling them to do was to just keep going as they had. That clearly wasn't working. He didn't say, take this and be as you have been. Teach them to sacrifice lambs and goats. That wasn't part of the equation. He was giving them a new message that represented the heart of God for all people. They were to take that forward. What does this mean for us? It means that when we share the message of the gospel, we may look at our methods and see that they need to adapt to culture. Our message can stay the same because it represents God's unchanging heart for people. He wants them to come to know him. What we need to get past are the ways that we've been functioning in all along. We need to look at ourselves and say, how can we do this better? Jesus was offering them a better way. And this better way was then spelled out for the disciples as Jesus was ascending into heaven when he told them, as we talked about last week, to wait. Wait until you receive the Holy Spirit, that promised gift. Because in receiving the Holy Spirit, they were then in a position where they could minister in ways that they'd never known before, with tremendous power and tremendous effect. Now, here's where we have to be thinking about this. When we look at ourselves, whether it's as a church or as spouses, as parents, as people in the workplace, as students in school, when we look at ourselves, we have to pause and say, could I be doing better? could I be more effective? And husbands, you may be asking yourself right now, well, don't ask my wife. Of course, she has some ideas about how I can be better. And wives, you might be thinking the same of your husbands. But in the heart of hearts of who we are, as we set all of that stuff aside, of course, we want to be better. What husband doesn't want to love his wife more fully? What wife doesn't want to reciprocate that for her husband? Parents, don't we want to be the best we can be for our kids, to raise them up in this changing landscape of North America, and for that matter, just right here in Saugeen Shores? Don't we want to equip them so that they can rise to the challenge that the day represents? Of course we do. And the question is how? So if Jesus didn't say, keep doing what you've been doing, what did he say? In Acts, and we talked about this last week, he said, wait until you receive the Holy Spirit. Whatever you're going to do, disciples, don't go running off thinking that you can just, you know, take on the world. Yes, you have a powerful, powerful message. And certainly, it's a message that the world needs to hear. But if you want to get it done, and you want to have impact, wait. Wait until you receive what you're going to get from the Heavenly Father, that gift of the Holy Spirit. And they may be thinking to themselves, you know, well, come on, Jesus, we did some miracles. We saw you at work. Certainly, we've got a handle on how to do this. The point that Jesus is making is, when you receive the Holy Spirit, it's going to go to a whole different level. What did that look like? Well, in Acts chapter 2, and this is where I want us to turn now, we read this. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all gathered together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and as a result of that infilling, they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. But now listen to this, because here's the profound advantage that the Holy Spirit gave them. You see, the first thing is, it was the day of Pentecost. And while we in the church understand that the day of Pentecost is the day that the Holy Spirit came upon the early disciples and the church was started. For the Jewish people, the day of Pentecost was a feast that happened 50 days after the Passover. For them, it was already a holiday. It was already a time of celebration. And as a result of that, Jewish people from all around the Mediterranean had gathered there, and you begin to see the pieces coming together. It says, now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each of them heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they said, aren't these all who are speaking Galileans? How then is it that each of us hears them in our own language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Do you see? The disciples might have had this, you know, incredible desire to be all they could be for Jesus. And who doesn't want to be that? Again, in the various different ways that we live out our lives as followers of Christ, we all want to be at our best, whether it's in the church or in functioning in the community, in our families, in our schools, workplaces, the whole of where we live. We want to be our best. And the disciples had that zeal. But Jesus said, wait, because you're going to receive something that will, to your zeal and to your desire, add something that is beyond comprehension. In this moment, in this particular amazing moment of time, God gives them the abilities to speak in other tongues. And as a result of that, people from all around the known world at that time, their world was impacted, and the people, didn't matter where they were from, they're amazed because they're hearing the praises of God, the wonders of God, and most importantly, that salvation message being proclaimed to them in their own language by people who couldn't speak that language. Huh. And here's the thing. Culture has changed. And for some of us, you know, with less hair or maybe more gray hair, we wonder if times whether we speak the language of our culture, whether we even understand the culture that we find ourselves in. The wonder of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, the guidance of the Holy Spirit, all of the things that is brought into our lives when we have the Holy Spirit within us, one of the most amazing things is that it gives us a capacity to minister far beyond that which we've known. We don't have to, you know, try and invest ourselves into knowing culture, because in an amazing way, God equips us. Culture is changing rapidly. And in the midst of it, it can be very, very overwhelming. It can be hard as parents to know how to raise up your kids in the midst of everything in this world. And maybe at times, as kids, you're feeling, you know, that my parents don't understand me. Can I suggest that right here, we're given a powerful, powerful tool of understanding. When we seek to know our God, when we pray and say, Lord, help us, help me to raise up my child in the way that you would have me. Help me to be the kind of husband that my wife deserves. Help me to be the kind of employee that makes a difference in the workplace, not only in the job that I'm doing, but in the person that I am as a follower of Christ. You know, there are moments when we can all look at ourselves and say, how? How am I able to do this? And there may be times when we throw up our hands and say, I got nothing. When we have the Holy Spirit in our lives, we have a wisdom, we have a guidance, we have a power that enables us to be for those around us exactly what God would have us be, with the message that God would have them know. It's an incredibly liberating thing. You know, the reality is that when culture changes, we can feel like we're caught in this trap. And I love what again, Kerry Newhoff said in response to it. He said, sometimes we can try to keep up to culture and stay cool. Sorry. You know, there it is. I'm using a word that isn't cool anymore. Do you see? It's a game, and you can't play it. We can't pretend to be all up on culture when we stop being who we are. And what Kerry Newhoff went on to say was that the people that God has given to us to minister to, they don't need cool. They don't need people who are pretending. They don't need ones who are all hype and no substance. What they need is real. There are times when I don't know how to be the real that people in our world need. And that's where the Holy Spirit comes in and gives us that capacity to be real in ways that we can never imagine. We will find ourselves having conversations where the words coming out of our mouths aren't ours exactly. You know, if you've ever experienced those times when you have an amazing conversation with someone about Christ or about a situation and you're walking them through, and when everything is done, you know, you sit back and go, I didn't think I could do that, or I didn't think I had it in me. You didn't. It was God. And that's what we need. Our kids need parents who get them, who can guide them forward without having to be their best friend, who can be a mom and a dad and still have the kids appreciate them for who they are. That's being real. In the workplace, our employers or us as the employed or the employers ourselves, you know, we can be the boss, we can be on the floor of the shop. It doesn't matter the role we have. But who we work with needs somebody who's real. And in those low places, because let's face it, not everybody who comes to work wants to be there. Not everybody who comes to work is ready to work. They're dealing with the situation that happened at home last night. And who's going to minister to them in that moment? Who is going to be the real voice that they hear and that they look to and listen? They listen to words coming from our mouths. And may it be that after the fact, we know it wasn't us doing the talking. That's what Jesus was putting in front of the disciples, and that's what they modeled. At the end of the day, were they misunderstood? Yeah, of course. You know, some thought they were drunk because, you know, here it is 9 a.m. and these people are talking gibberish. But to the ones who heard and knew what was being said, it was not gibberish. The message was heard. It was received. And it had impact. And there's the thing. You know, at the end of the day, parents, through the Holy Spirit, you'll be given words to say to your kids. And it doesn't matter if you're cool in your kids' eyes or not. They want a mom and a dad who's real. In the workplace, beyond the job that we're doing, people want to work alongside of someone who they can talk to. Someone who can be there, and they're not just there for the job. In our schools, we need teachers and we need students who are there to learn, but also there to make a difference. Because a difference needs making. There are unquestionably times, and I remember, you know, in grade 7, I remember one of these. On both sides of the equation. I remember a teacher who lost his cool with the class. And, you know, he sort of pulled himself back together and he said, you know, I'm just going through stuff and you know, it's not your concern and I'm sorry I lost my cool with you. And you know, in that moment, I remember we went outside for recess and we're all talking about how our teacher lost his mind in the class. And you know, in that moment, what would it look like if a kid went back and said, "Hey, are you okay? You know, don't sweat it. All of us are dealing with stuff." And if that kid was a believer and said, "Hey, you know what? I will be praying for you. Being a teacher isn't easy." Sounds far-fetched, doesn't it? But what if they could? What if a student could say that? Not trying to be cool and all of that, but just in the quietness of a heart who cares, had the Holy Spirit giving words that would make a difference in a teacher's life. I remember another time, one of the kids had just lost his grandfather. And, you know, tried to go to school, but the impact was more than his emotions could carry. And the kid broke down. What if a classmate or a teacher, you know, moved by a heart of compassion, moved by, you know, that fruit of the Spirit that is gentleness and kindness, came alongside and didn't have to do anything other than just put a hand on a shoulder and say, "Hey, I'm here for you. Do you see?" Simple things. But I remember each of those instances happening when I was in grade 7. And the impact that was there to be made. I wish I'd made it. But here's the thing. And you know, I say that a lot. Here's the thing. We have opportunities like that all around us, all the time. And we can't get stuck in the kind of pattern that Jesus didn't tell his disciples to continue in. And that pattern is one that can be very easy for all of us in different ways. Think about this for a moment. You're a parent, and you think to yourself, "Man, it was so much easier when they were just little." You know, I marvel sometimes. We want our kids to grow up, right? And then they do. And we lament and we miss the stage that they were at previously. I loved it when our kids would stay put. You know, they're in their car seat or they're in their crib and that's where they stayed. But we want them to be mobile. And then when they're mobile, we're like, it'd be really nice that they, you know, could be somewhat independent and I didn't have to keep my eye on them to make sure they didn't fall downstairs or, you know, do something like that. And do you see? At every stage, we're wishing for something else rather than in that moment wishing we could be more of what our kid needed. And that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. You see, this plays out in any number of theaters. I talk to pastors, and what do? They wish it could go back to the 80s. Oh, it was so easy back then. All you had to do was have the right clothes and cool hair, and you know, you could do youth ministry. You could do anything. It was just so easy. I remember those days. Yes, I'm that old. I remember those days, and I remember thinking at the time, man, the people in the 70s, they had it so easy. And do you see what we do? We're wishing, you know, that somehow we could do the thing that we knew or the thing that we thought would work. Jesus didn't tell his disciples to do the thing that they knew. what they thought would work. What he wanted them to do was to enter into the time they had right then, right now. And through the Holy Spirit, be all that they could possibly be, guided by, directed by, given words by, given wisdom by, given actions to pick up and to apply to the situation right then. And even though that situation was changing, maybe by the day or by the week, and it was something new that they had to encounter, the Holy Spirit would be present with them in that moment to do what needed done. The worst thing we can do is to paralyze ourselves in the here and now, thinking about how it was easier back in the day. And whether we're as parents or as spouses, as workers in the workplace, or students in class, teachers in class, ministers and followers of Christ meeting the challenges of this time, the worst thing we can do is look back and think, man, if we could just do it the way we did. No. The message remains the same, but the power of the Spirit remains the same as well, to empower methods and ways and means of enabling us to be the real answer that our culture and our families and our people and our churches and our schools need right now. It is better to stay equipped by the Holy Spirit to meet the days and the hours and the minutes that we are living in right now than to wish for a form that we grew comfortable with in years past. We don't need to be cool and all hyped up in the times that we're in. We need to be real. We need to have the real message of salvation in Christ applied to the real needs that are in front of us right now. You may be thinking to yourself right now and saying, but Gary, you have no idea what I'm going through as a parent. You have no idea what I'm going through as a spouse. Maybe I don't. But I know and trust that through the Holy Spirit, what you need is available. Let's seek Him together to enable you to see that need met right now. Let's pray. Father, the disciples lived in changing, crazy times. There were times of war. There were times of famine and disease and poverty beyond imagine. There were times when tyrants ruled and the everyday man was subject to the whims of powers that he couldn't possibly meet. The lives of women and children were considered secondary. They were horrible times. But they were times of profound opportunity when God's people rose through the Holy Spirit and met the need of that day. And Lord, through your word, they realized that they could be better parents, they could be better spouses, they could be honorable workers serving their employers. They could, in every facet of their lives, bring forward the message of hope that is found in Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world. And everyday people became heroes because the Holy Spirit was working through them. Lord, we've lived in times for this past year where we talked a lot about frontline heroes. And for sure, the people in our healthcare system, the people who are serving and caring for our communities in so many different ways have been heroic in their actions. Our governments have had to walk through times that have been unbelievable. Lord, as we appeal to you now, as we look to you now, we serve in different places. We minister in different facets of life. We are husbands, wives, sons, daughters, teachers, students, employers, and employees. But Lord, in the common thread of being followers of Jesus Christ, we are given a greater message and a greater power to be who you would ask us to be. Lord, give us opportunity. And certainly, Lord, it goes without saying that the opportunities are in front of us. But Lord, help us to make the most of them. Lord, at the end of the day, may we find that the wonder of all wonders is that we will have words in our mouths that maybe we didn't even think were there, but they will be heard by someone who understands and who needs them in that moment. There will be actions that we didn't think ourselves capable of, or even maybe as we're doing them, we didn't know that we were, but they will be making a difference that needs making. Lord, thank you that while we take up the challenge of being all that you've called us to be, Lord, in you, it doesn't rest on our shoulders. It resides within us through your Holy Spirit. Thank you for this. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen. God bless each of you.
And fear.